To the first of a two-part history of psychedelia with David Quantick.
This is the Beatles.
Now on Radio 2, the first of a two-part history of psychedelia with David Quantick.
This is the Beatles. And this is the Beatles. This is the Yardbirds. And this is the Yardbirds. So how do we get from this to this? Hello, I'm David Quantick. You can think of me as Simon Sharma on acid, if it helps. And this is the story of psychedelia. In this week's show, and the one after, we'll be attempting to answer the question, what is psychedelia? And oddly, we'll be starting our quest in the least psychedelic country in the world. Switzerland. Pre-war Switzerland, actually, and the laboratory of Dr. Albert Hofmann. Dr. Hofmann accidentally discovered what we now know as LSD-25. He thought nothing much of it at the time, although his lab notes say the experimental animals became restless during the narcosis. Well, you'd be restless too if you'd just discovered the meaning of the Beagle universe and you didn't have a wah-wah pedal. Nothing else was done with the compound until some 5 years later, when Hofmann, perhaps after some prompting from the animals, decided to conduct further experiments.
Everything in my field of vision wavered and was distorted as if seen in a curved mirror. Pieces of furniture assumed grotesque, threatening forms. The lady next door, whom I scarcely recognized, was no longer Mrs. R., but rather a malevolent, insidious witch with a colored mask. Even worse than the demonic transformations of the outer world were the alterations that I perceived in myself. Was I dying? Was this the transition?
No, basically. Hofmann had become the first non-Beagle to drop a tab or take a trip. After that, and after thinking his bike could fly, nothing much happened until the 1960s, when the drug came to the attention of Professor Timothy Leary, a publicity-crazed academic from Harvard University. Leary began experiments with LSD on his students.
Turn on, tune in, and drop out.
Joe Boyd, who, perhaps not coincidentally, later went on to produce the Pink Floyd, Soft Machine, and the Incredible String Band, was a Harvard student at the time.
I remember when I was at Harvard in the early 60s, Timothy Leary and Richard Alpert were teachers, and they used to put an ad in the Harvard Crimson saying, subjects wanted, dollar an hour paid, psychological experiments. And if you went there, they gave you acid, and you got paid a dollar an hour to take acid. So that was very much a part of the scene in Harvard Square in the early 60s.
Leary left Harvard and began weekend experiments on volunteers in a great big country house. These were largely aimed at gaining some kind of spiritual insight from the drug. Here's an early report from the psychedelic frontier.
It's all to do with God. It's all to do with ground. It's shape. Everything's colour. Everything, you know, is... Oh, it must be to do with orange. Not only with orange.
So, what have we learned? An orange is round and orange. Well worth the risk of inducing a whole bunch of psychiatric disorders. Nevertheless, the kids went mad for it. Literally. Leary set the age of consent for LSD use at 7, although probably in Holland, it was a lot lower. Here's a couple of proto-ravers phoning in from Planet Bernard.
You're introduced to LSD, and unless you've taken some other drug, like for instance, like marijuana or something, It's an altogether new thing. And it's funny because I took a very low dosage, yet it was one of the most powerful sessions I've ever had. You know, you can get very high on a low dosage.
Meanwhile, Ken Kesey, a young wrestler stroke author, think Hulk Hogan crossed with Irvin Welsh, it was the 60s, was about to enter another dimension. He volunteered to undergo drug testing at the Menlo Park Veterans Hospital in San Francisco.
At the time, I was training for the Olympics in wrestling. And I was a full-scale American jock, as all-American as it gets. I didn't smoke, I didn't drink. When I was asked to do these drug experiments, I thought this was part of our American personality. You try to go down deeper in the ocean and up higher in the sky, and these drugs were opening the door to new landscapes. And from then on, I went through the whole spectrum of drugs. I took psilocybin, mescaline, LSD-6, LSD-25, cannabinol, a lot of drugs that only had numbers, JD-318.
And they say it's fixed. Kesey, somewhat unexpectedly, took to the drugs and decided that the world needed to know about one drug in particular, LSD-25. He set about organizing a set of free-form, gig-happening drug orgy experiences, the legendary acid tests.
The acid tests were a way of getting people together, going through what can be a hellish experiment, and finding that there's people around you who are doing the same thing, and it's positive.
San Francisco's always had a liberal, artistic heart, and it was the perfect place to incubate a bohemian revolution. Spearheading that revolution was the house band of the acid tests, the Warlocks, who later changed their name to the Grateful Dead. Possibly the only Grateful Dead fan who can remember what he had for breakfast, let alone what he was doing in 1966, Dennis McNally is the band's historian and biographer.
They were formed in the crucible of the acid tests. What happened to them in the acid tests is that they were not the show. There was no show. Or if there was a show, it consisted in everyone in the room. It set a template for the Grateful Dead for really the next 30 years, which was... the audience was the show, the dancers were the show, and the band was merely the soundtrack.
Jerry Garcia.
We were playing to dancers, you know, people who were taking LSD or other kinds of chemicals and dancing. And I mean, dancing their hearts out.
They weren't conventionally psychedelic. That was Blur. The Dead were always very much an improvisational live band, which is essentially what makes them psychedelic. Dennis McNally.
Jerry Garcia once said that playing live was like being on a ship crossing the ocean in the middle of a raging storm, whereas working in the studio was like making a ship in a bottle.
And sometimes for the Grateful Dead, playing live was like being on a hairy island surrounded by pulsating shapes from another dimension. They took a lot of LSD whilst playing live, and almost uniquely among their peers, they found that it helped.
Frequently with psychedelics, I couldn't talk to anybody. I couldn't make myself understood, and I couldn't understand what people were saying to me. But I could communicate with music, no problem.
Of all the Dead's live output, and believe me, there's a spaceship load, Dark Star from the album Live Dead is perhaps their finest work.
Dark Star is a vehicle. It's barely a song. It's an attitude, and it's a series of chord changes and two short verses. And they could take it anywhere. And everything about the song inherently drove the music outward into outer space, really. Garcia and Lesh and the drummers probably did LSD two-thirds of their shows for 5 years. They found it a way to pursue the ideal of a group mind and, frankly, experienced it as levels of synchronicity in which they could all together make group decisions musically without verbalizing anything and go places that one would say were really quite impossible.